For this episode of the podcast, I had a guest and my friend Katie Basso joined to talk about today's movie. After seeing this movie last week, we both had some thoughts about it that we wanted to share. I was excited to see this movie. Baz Luhrmann is not a guy who makes movies all that often. But the last one, I think, Katie, you had told me that the last one he had made was Gatsby, right?
Yes, and then the show that unfortunately has been discontinued, and I'm very embarrassed to say it's on the tip of my tongue.
The Netflix one.
Yes, it's on Netflix, everybody.
So Jaden Smith's show with Baz Luhrmann was The Get Down, right? Like, and that was a big, I remember, production for them. I saw part of it, like, I thought it was going to be a success for them, but then they cut it after one season, I think, right?
They cut it after one season, and a lot of people don't really understand why. So have you seen the movie Strictly Ballroom?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's kind of the first time. That was the first time I saw that type of editing, you know, Tina Sparkles, the makeup. You know, it's just very intense, very ballsy.
You know, movies like Strictly Ballroom, reimagining of Romeo and Juliet, Moulin Rouge, which is still one of my favorites of all time, and then, you know, Great Gatsby, Australia, and now the movie that we're going to be talking about today, Elvis. Let's talk for a minute.
If you're looking for trouble, you came to the right place. If you're looking for trouble, just look right in my face.
Let me ask you this. If you had to give someone a quick summary or pitch of this movie you just saw, when you're going to go see Elvis, the Baz Luhrmann, you know, adaptation version, here's what you're going to see.
You're going to see you're going to get your Baz jazz, okay? You know, you're going to get your thirst for all that hyper, you know, the details are going to be hyper. So I'll just get that out of the way. It has to be said. You're gonna, as far as a story and with the actors, you're gonna get not a romanticized version of his life, but a very intimate, surprising, often, even though it is a very jazzed up Baz movie, it's almost very intimate for Baz. It becomes sentimental. So instead of going straight to the bam, tabloid, typical Elvis talk, you know, highlights of his life, you gotta go into those deep crevices and those deep ditches. And they might not always be pleasant, but like, how has this not been told? So it's so eye-opening. You're gonna get more than you expect, is what I'll say.
What I appreciated about the movie was, even though we're talking about Elvis and his story and some of the conflicts he had with his family or through his work, you know, work relationships, this movie in so many ways, it might sound strange, reminded me of Moulin Rouge. Quick score, just from the top, out of 10, what would you give it out of 10?
So there's two things actually I would grade. So there's two scores from me. Okay. One score is, you know, how wonderful is the film in my opinion? And the second score is, it's a long movie. You know, is it worth the theater or not? I'm just going to go ahead and call that one.
Okay.
It's worth the theater.
Yeah, so, totally.
So anyways, 1 to 10, I would say it's a very high 8, which is surprisingly grandiose in its stature. I mean, it's a wonderful movie. I think even rewatching it a few times is necessary.
Now, I don't know the intimate details of Elvis and his life and all of that. I actually was thinking like 9.5. Now, I know at least why I would take off the 0.5. I'll bring up that later in the con section. I just really liked...
You feel that.
it's subjective. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that's the thing. Like, yeah. People who listen to this, I'm not expecting them to agree with my rating, with your rating. What I want to get out of this podcast, for example, is just I want people to go see movies. And if we want to debate, I'm happy to debate it. But your view is your view, mine is mine. I can be at peace with that at the end of the day. Now, I kind of want to switch to the prose section. Three things that I liked about the movie Elvis. First, I want to talk about the acting. Austin Butler as Elvis was phenomenal.
Yeah.
I don't think the criticism, I've heard a lot of criticism about Tom Hanks as Colonel Parker. I thought he was great. And people were saying, oh, okay, but he's a little over the top. He's a caricature. That's what he was supposed to be.
Yeah, and that's also exactly how he was wanting to be portrayed by who was making this film, and, you know.
The second thing that I really liked about this movie was, I mean, I'm thinking in particular about the editing, but the editing is only possible when he has it shot a certain way, when the lighting is a certain way. All those, you said the costumes, you know, that are made. I mean, just everything about Luhrmann's style. And again, like, I always come back to thinking about it through the editing. It's just that all parts of it create this unique style that I don't see in other movies at all. That's why I love going to Baz Luhrmann movies. I know it's going to be a unique experience. The third thing about it too was I liked learning about Elvis. I'm a person who didn't know much about Elvis and his story, so I like that I got to learn more that his music had a lot to do with his upbringing, it had a lot to do with being in the South, it had a lot to do with gospel, it had a lot to do with the racial tensions, you know, at that time, 1950s and 60s. Yeah, I didn't know that he had friendships and relationships with like B.B. King and like, you know, various other performers of the time.
Some were absolutely not about it.
Yeah.
Top things to watch for in this movie. Okay, so we've established that this is a please go to the theater. I'm clapping my hands. Please go to the theater.
Go.
You know, I'm going to clap for it. Yeah. Go to the theater, y'all. Go to the theater. It's worth going for the experience, especially because, you know, the music. It's, you know, by the way, learning that he really did sing that was quite
Austin Butler.
Humbling. Yeah, it's okay. Austin Butler. It's been years because a lot of music, especially from his past, I guess something about, you know, over time, just like film, I say film, the acidity and stuff eat away at the ability. So he had to learn quite a bit. He spent like 2 years, you mentioned, like learning things about like voice. And...
Well, to your point, he's been in a lot of like CW series and like a lot of like teen stuff. And then... Then I think he had a bit role in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, so like Tarantino movie.
Oh yeah, lucky, that's fun.
And now he's going to be in the next Dune movie. Okay, so the guy's doing well. Now, let's transition over to the cons for this movie.
People going in, a possible very obvious con is the length. Mm-hmm. Second is if you're not into loud, surprising hyper moments, this is not the film for you. You could wait. I'll just be honest. Like, this is a Baz Luhrmann film. Like, you know, very obvious.
It actually makes me think of David Fincher with Social Network. Even though these are very, very different styles of movies, there is not a moment in that movie where like the beat is not moving forward. It's just everything's happening very fast and it doesn't slow down.
Correct.
So again, stylistically very different, but Baz Luhrmann does that here too. So like if you're not ready, I'm totally with you on that. Yeah. Just the very fast paced editing,
in
the talking.
Face.
Yeah. Very in
if
your
you're
face.
Not into a very colorful experience. A
lot of like montages when they
want
to all the like 60s stuff when they want to show like when he's going to do his concerts, when he's rebelling against the like people saying, all right, don't, you know, wiggle or thrust as much or whatever. Like,
and
just
go back and forth from the booth.
You were saying to also touch on the part about time, like the length of it. So there are times where like I'll get annoyed with the length of a film, you know, very easily. But then there are some movies where if you kind of just keep it going, I'm entertained, I'm engaged, it could be 3.5 hours and I wouldn't care because I wouldn't feel it. This movie, 2 hours and 40 minutes, I don't think until halfway through the third act I was even paying attention at the time. But then towards the end, I'm like, oh, it feels like for a little bit of this, they don't know how to stick the landing.
We need a landing zone, y'all. Like, we're up in the air, kind of like my conversations. Like, we're going to keep going around until they stop us. So.
It just, you know, it was like earlier this year, I remember I went to see The Batman and nearly
a... That he said The Batman.
Sorry?
Can you say it slower, like The Batman? Sorry. No, but they call it The Batman still.
Batman. With Batman, like this one that came out this year, like it was, you know, just under 3 hours. And again, I loved it until the last 20 minutes. It was the same feeling with this movie. Like the last, maybe not 20 minutes, last like 10 minutes.
Yes.
Like, I'm like, where, this is not.
I'm not satisfied with the ending.
Yeah.
I will say that's a con. How about that? We all know, everybody knows, you know, Elvis unfortunately is not here.
Right.
But the reality is we are not going to tell you why these last 10 minutes for Sohrab and myself are not ideal for what we would hope Baz would use as the ending. However, this is why I say it kind of brings a little bit of romance to an ending of a very tragic story. I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah, well,
you know, it's very biopic. It's not, you know, Lisa Marie's hardly really in it.
Yeah.
I'll go ahead and throw that out there, y'all. So, girls, I mean, get ready for a very biopic. Not as much hair and dresses,
That's where the 0.5 for me comes off. If the ending, if the third act itself, you know, was kind of a mess, like I'd say at least a point, if not more. But I felt like it just, the movie overall was still really good. This part was like, just kind of like, okay. Like this last little bit was clunky, but I enjoyed the rest so much that I didn't care.
Yes.
I agree with you. It's almost like it seemed like everybody was tired and they did such a good job. Yeah. Like at a football game where like they've slaughtered the other team.
Yeah.
And I hate to use that word. So like it's almost like they did such a good job that they figured like, oh, let's just walk off the set. Everybody's going to like it. Like yeah, they probably could have in reality. But I agree. The ending.
There's running the clock.
Romanticisms. But it's like you have to come up almost with your own ending to it because it is dissatisfying.
Yeah.
And it's cheesy.
If you have like a running list of movies that like you need to see in the theater, I think this one should be on it. You know what I mean?
I would say this is going to end up being quite... This is going to be a very influential movie in many ways.
This movie gives me hope that people are coming back to the movie theater and does not be just for a Marvel movie. I love Marvel movies. Don't get me wrong. Disney. Yeah.
I've seen one.
You know, like...
I still don't even understand it.
People are coming back and it doesn't have to be just for the big blockbusters. This has a blockbuster kind of feel the way it's made.
This is gold. Yeah. So I'm going to add to that really quick. The way that you mentioned it... I feel like the wow factor that, again, a reason to come to the movies, you know, the wow factor of this. I like to use the term, you don't need to spend, you know, half the budget on pyrotechnics and blowing up and something negative. And nothing against Marvel movies. They're beautiful. I just have not happened to see very many of them. It's nothing against them. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows there's a bajillion things to watch. So, hashtag staircase stuff, you know what I mean?
Sure. Staircase on HBO, another good series.
Yeah, it's really good. So the movie is a true biopic film without being tabloidish and going straight for the juicy stuff I intently thought was going to be in this movie. Okay. And it is not. It is very much not. This is very humanistic and very, I mean, you get the goosebumps. I mean, it's very intimate. You almost feel like you shouldn't be there at certain moments.
Okay. But still maybe more subdued than you were expecting? Like
the moments of it are romantic, like I said, or sacred. How about that? Okay. Very sacred and intimate.
I don't know. This already for me is not just for saying you should go see this in the theater, but this is, I know, going to be in my top 10 list of the year. I have a very strong feeling on that.
We have to have a lot of talks about this.
Yeah. Elvis, you know, Baz Luhrmann finally back on the big screen. Quick recap on the score. You were saying 8, I think, for...
Well, you got me feeling weak in the knees about it because I think it should be a 9. It's just hard for me. I'll say an 8.75 to a 9. It's pretty close to as good as you can get. There are my own, you know, silly reasons, but it's high up there, y'all. It's really, really, you'd be missing out not seeing it. I would say that this movie is worth going to the theater and having the full experience. And this comes from a girl who loves being at home, you know, in her creature comfort, watching it. But there's something about Baz and that red velvet curtain appeal. If you don't understand how a red curtain applies with Baz, then, you know, I'm going to let you figure that out. But that's kind of what they say about him. That's his style. It's like red curtain. Like,
I feel it. If as an audience, you don't know or you're not familiar with that, go see more of his movies. Rent more of his stuff. Watch Strictly Ballroom. Watch Romeo, Juliet, DiCaprio, and Claire Danes. Moulin Rouge. I cannot emphasize that one enough. To recap on the score, though, I want to say for myself, as a movie overall, still 9.5 out of 10. One of my favorite movies of the year. Katie, you enjoyed it?
One of my favorite movies of the year.
Elvis by Baz Luhrmann. Definitely want to check out in the theater. I hope you see it.
Let us know what you think.
And I just wanted to say thank you, Katie, for joining me on the podcast today. It was a lot of fun, and we got to do this again soon. And of course, as always, for all of you out there tuning in, thanks for listening. We're caught in a trap.